Very happy to attend this cloud native to serve our platform from Tencent. I'm very happy to be the first speaker. And today's content will include several parts, and my colleague and I will co-deliver the speech. I have three parts to be made. Number one, I'll introduce this cloud function, and it's called SCF, and it's a function platform. I will talk about architecture design and why do you need to have such optimization. I will talk about the co-start for the function. Number three, I will introduce several ways to optimize co-start.
In terms of serverless platform, it serves
three scenarios. Number one,
I believe
that you are very familiar with that, is called the WeChat small app development. If you look at the WeChat small app, which is based on the VM, but in recently, it's just used the Tencent function algorithm to be the service provider, and number two, the public cloud businesses,
and
number three, and I believe that the cloud will be the future trend. Some traditional businesses are transferred to the cloud based on VM and the container, and if you look at some creative businesses, they will just use the function computing to do this part. If you look at the function, Tencent Cloud function platform, we have three ways. One is this event invoker, and will be a trigger, and this is one of the ways. And number two, an HTTP access or call, which is a simple way. It means that create a function and generate a URL to have such a way. Number three, and it will support the web developing architecture, let's say. It's a very typical architecture operation way, and it will support these businesses to be run on the cloud. And if you look at this business scenario, and I believe that support some public businesses of these WeChat small apps, they have a strong demand for this security isolation. And I believe that for the small apps, which is based on the millions of developers, so that's why our function should have some scalability, strong scalability. It should have a higher requirements on the concurrency, so that's why the single cluster can be as high as 10,000 of millions of scale, millions of level. And we also have strong requirements on the co-start. If you open the WeChat small app for the first time, if there will be some delay or latency, it will lead to bad experiences for these end users. So that's why we have such challenges, if you look at the slides. So our SAF architecture has undergone some ups and downs and optimizations. And if you look at this architecture chart, we have this yellow and the blue part. If you look at the blue, it's the control stream. The yellow is the data call stream. If you look at the blue part, in the middle, if you look at here, we use some decoupling to do this, to decouple this part. We have such a very lightweight API to generate a function or improve this function after going to the library, and it will just design designated a task, and there will be several modules that will focus on the moves of this function. Let's say if we generate a function, if you look at this web module, it will just be ready to open the path. And if you look at here, this function management code, it will just rely on this function based on the dependency, and we will have such a library. And there is also this call module here, and by doing this, we can just handle this call start. If there is some scalability or delete some inversions, and it can just sense this event, that's why it can be ready for these moves. And we also have the metadata. It will control the data stream. And for this data, its concurrency is very high. It cannot just search this database. And that's why when there is a data change, we can have the simultaneous changes. We can just realize the purpose of decoupling. And if we have this underlying part here, in terms of optimizing cost, we have several directions. One is this VM with its lightweight virtualized system. And this interaction, this function must be coupled with this public network and this cloud, which will have an impact on the cost start. If you look at here, in terms of the scalability, we will scale this function if there is cold start or when there is a concurrent function call. We must think about how to control the cost or optimize the cost of this function platform. In terms of the call party and the WeChat small app and cloud and other scenarios and some terminal access with HTTP to do this access. And if you look at here, this timer, and it's also good. And here, if you look at this pool, it's instance pool, the function pool, and that is focused on the cold start. We use this pool to make all of the resources ready, and with this instance, it can be communicated in a very fast way. It's quite great. And let's talk about the problems of the function cold start. And I believe that it is the first time when deploying the function instance. Let's think about our work in writing a program. We will be confronted with a lot of problems in terms of code. But let's say GCP, maybe three handshakes. If you look at the UDP for the first communication, you must have the NLRP communication or broadcasting. So that's why that will be some process here. But in terms of the function code start, why should it be a problem within our business? If you look at some blogs, there are heated discussions on the optimization of the function code start. That's why I spent a lot of time and efforts in optimizing this code start. I believe that some developers have different expectations on this function code start. It's different from the local function scenario. The local function may be, there will not be very exact time to optimize or use this code start. But if you look at the cloud function, and there will be some preparation work for the first time, maybe from these hundreds of ms to or several seconds. And for some sensitive businesses or some first-time call timeout, we also are confronted with this problem that I just mentioned. And I believe that it's very flexible or elastic. When there will be the concurrent call, we must be prepared for that. When this concurrency decline, there will be distributed resources. So that's why it will have a big impact on our businesses. And let's have a look at these cold start stages. Now, what stages does it have? I just have the chart. If you look at this blue part, and it's a call path when they request it here. And if there is an instance existing, it just send a request to this down level. And I believe this path is at MS level. If it's not MS level, it will just turn to this blue part. And there will be we call this cold start. I will introduce these three stages. If you look at this cold start, I believe these three stages are quite important. Stage one. You have to prepare these underlying resources for computing, let's say the VM container, I mean, this great VM container, if you look at this public cloud VM products, if you buy them, and if you must need this minute level, and for the container, you need this second level. And if you use the VM container, I believe that you will find no problem in this part. You just deploy it once. But in terms of function, or for this invoke or this call path, it will be very essential. Set to download function code. It depends on the package size or the bandwidth. I believe that in the public cloud, this internal network bandwidth is very high, and it will be the gigabyte level. And the code will be several KB to 100 or 200 MB, and the downloading time will be several or dozens of MS. And the stage three will be this network channel. Especially work with this DPC and use this elastic this graphic card to do it. If we deploy this elastic graphic card or this routing path, I believe that it will be the second level. So that's why we make some optimization in this regard. So we will focus on this container and VM and this code catching, deploy, network deploy, or some module design. Number one, let's introduce the micro VM system. It's based on the public cloud CVI teamwork. We just optimize it. This is the underlying invoke, and it's focused on the underlying or VM or virtual scenarios. We have this call module. We just cut the system to make it very lightweight from seconds to 200 milliseconds and concurrency from 1,000 to 10,000. In terms of networking route, it must be have the separation from the VM. It must have some communication. When it is large scale, this network data transfer will require milliseconds level. So for this routing data, we just download them in advance. And if you look at number three, virtualizing, if you look at the traditional VM, it is a minutes level start. So that's why we have this lightweight cutting for this system. And how does it work? For the invoke, if you look at the Kubernetes or public cloud VM invoking system, and there are a lot of factors to be considered. There will be some first or second generation versions, and there will be some custom config or CPU or SSD, CPU affinity and anti-affinity deployment group or CPU consumption. And I believe that there will be some the different requirements on the resource utilization or deploy group. And a lot of other considerations, let's say how to call this macrolithic, monolithic. So we believe that a lot of factors should be considered. If you look at the CVM call platform, I believe that there's 20 factors should be considered. And if this physical machine is very large scale, and I believe it will take quite a long time. So in response to the function scenarios, we have this custom call platform. For this function VM, we do some cutting.
Another one is to
have some offline computing for this retention resources or these redundant resources. And number one will be this lightweight VM system. And I believe that KVM Cumul is very popular right now. The Kata, Firecracker, are very popular. Coupled with some plans for VM. In terms of Tencent, we have this similar philosophy in terms of the image and kernel module. We do some cutting on this above mentioned aspects, let's say they cut this image volume to improve its starting time. Our Tencent Cloud VM lightweight system, we have made some optimizations in terms of start. We have two stages. After cutting this image, we have such a very base VM. And we just detect some kernel. I'll just post it. With this VM, we make a VM template. That will include this memory, CPU, dev status, and Cumul image, and this a lot of information will record it into here, will be recorded here. And after that, when we generate a real VM, we will be focused on this template. It's like this migration. We just migrate this data into a new VM to finish this VM work, and it will very fast for us to do the starting work. And it should focus on this image. The previous VM will have two layers of image, but for ours now we have three layers of image. The third layer will be this lightweight VM image. We do this optimization to recycle resources. With such a fast reset, we can just do this return to this image, and with the snapshot, we can just return this VM. If you look at here, we can do some modification. We can just do this operation to modify this agent. And if you look at the code caching, and I believe that it's just close connected with the size of this developer requirements. And let's say this code caching, we will do some optimization. We have two layers of cache. If you look at this region, the user's code will be just inside this inventory, and there will be some two layers of cache, level one, node local cache. For this VM, it just focuses on the user and running two functions, let's say this function C and function D. Maybe we just call it them immediately, but we just download all of these codes here for the further usage. So that's why it will be provide convenience for our future work. And if one developer haven't had such a computing node or used this function C and D, that's why we will have such this weight code cache here. We need to do this level 2 node. We can just call these functions from this inventory, so it will be very convenient.
Now,
I will introduce autoscaling. And I believe that for My part, I just introduced our experiments in terms of cold start. And if you look at here, we do not need, we will focus on this autoscaling. For this autoscaling, I believe there were two bottlenecks.
How can you predict the concurrency, whether it's going to increase or not? And then second, how can you predict the cost? Otherwise, there will be a lot of redundant cost. Therefore, in autoscaling, we try to find a balance. You can see that this autoscaling is not an offline analysis, computation analysis. You can see that the fluctuation is really intense. If you calculate offline, it's not possible to reach demand. Therefore, we have an autoscaling system here. By invoke the function, we will gather all of the monitoring data and try to know the concurrency real time, as well as the available resources real time. And then we will initiate the invoking system to recycle or even use these data resources. And we will basically optimize this part. How much space is to be scaled? That is based on the real-time calculation. We also did a lot of models, such as machine learning. And then we realized if you learn from the history, we cannot get a very good result because in the function scenario, because the granularity is very small and the fluctuation is very high. There might be a certain pattern there, and you might. However, it is still very difficult to predict or estimate the peak or low point. So we did some of other explorations, real-time calculation. We only calculate the most recent points. And after the calculation, we will try to determine whether we need to, what kind of autoscaling we need to have. Each point represents the current concurrency value. And if we identify the current concurrency value, and then we will calculate the next point. And then there will also be the straight line represents a cold space because we don't have an auto scaling immediately. The blue line looks like the purple line, however, they are not in sync. We also had our consideration in autoscaling, try to reduce the concurrency in cold start. You can see here it has a one or two times of surge, but it is still within our coverage. The highest peak time will still be within our cold start range. We also, apart from the cold start time, we also have a different stage of separation. The current value may be at this current concurrency. However, we reduce it to the recent peak concurrency. Try to ensure that the following concurrency point will not be more beyond the previous ones. By this module, we will run several thousands of functions and when we did all of the autoscaling, the cold start rate is very low, it's just 0.00. certain number of
rate.
How can we have a rapid cold start with a high concurrency that really rely on the underlying capabilities? Otherwise, if the time takes too long, or the concurrency is not big enough. So the autoscaling will also depends on the underlying capabilities that we've talked before.
一个比较可预测的一种提前预破容的一种场景。
We also
look
at the predictable pre-warming.
链式调用的一个场景。
For example, we use function A to invoke function B. If we've already got an instance in function A, however, we don't have a pre-warming in function B, then when it returns to function A, we will still realize, we will still see that the whole invoking time takes too long. This is an already known scenario. We know that when we invoke function A, we need to already pre-warm function B and C. That's why we can have we can scale function B and C beforehand. And then this is the update of the latest version. If you don't have the latest version and use the latest version as a default, maybe the previous code had 100 concurrency and then you upload the code and then the version will be switched to the latest one. However, in our model, we will know the function changing process. We will already predict this event in our and predict the concurrency and then pre-start the instances and then start to have the version exchanges. And then the second is we can use an alias to represent version 1, and then if we need to have 30% to version 2, then we can have this kind of operation. The scheduler module will calculate the concurrency of version 1, and then use 30% of the traffic and to see how much resources we need, and then to start the scheduler.
Next,
we're going to talk about the network module optimization, and my colleague will going to share. Hi, I'm from Tencent Cloud. My name is Zhou Yanbo. I talked about this topic before in Beijing, so I'll just be brief. Apart from calculation, we also have network access request. For example, request VPC. VPC is a logical segregation network space in Tencent Cloud. And the second scenario is to access internet. For example, you can access the data center via the public network. The output IP, when you try to visit the sensitive websites, for example, the payment API, and the traditional, let's look at the traditional network. If you try to visit the VPC, the traditional architecture is like this. There are two solutions. The first solution is within the container, create access the VPC resources. And you will have a random EIP. This is a new device. And then the container you can visit the VPC via this container. If the concurrency increases, then you and you need another container, then you can you will need the NAT to. And that will also require a new VM, and the whole time will take about 7 seconds. And also in some cold start, because it takes more time.
In the,
and it takes time to in the it will consume the ENI and also will consume some more resources. That will lead to an error. The second solution is similar to the first solution to create an ENI in normal. And this solution is better than solution one because for the new containers, if it is already in node, then you don't have to create the ENI additionally. If it is in the a new node, then you will have to create a new ENI. That is similar to the scenario before. And if you fail to create ENI, then you will fail to run the function. Now let's look at SI solution, SCF. So in this solution, we will create an SSCF net proxy in the middle layer. An ARP will be associated to the net proxy. When the customer visit VPC, the IP will be unpacked to VPC, and then you will be separated into out and C. This is the second grade response. And when the traffic increases, we will create a new proxy automatically. Compared to traditional architecture, and the new thing about the solution is that we are creating function. When we are creating function or creating this proxy, the previous solutions are creating ENI, EIP. So in SCF architecture, we only need to have an IP internal. And when you run the function, you don't have to create an EIP, and that was significantly lower down the time and reduce error. Now let's look at the access internet by using the traditional solution. There are also two scenarios. Firstly, you don't need the fixed IP to visit the public network. So you will have a very big NAT. And then you use the random EIP to visit the public network. If you do need the function, then firstly you will have to have a shared container. And then in the customer VPC, and you need to deploy a net, and then transform it to forward it to the public network. This process should be done by the customer themselves. And the whole process is more complicated. And also, if the net proxy, you don't have any process, even you don't have any resources going on, it will still be too costly. And if you use fixed IP, you have to use the function container and connect the network with the container. So the Next, let's look at the SCF network solution. We use the same traditional design because we also use, we will have a net shared in the whole architecture. So you don't have to use the fixed IP to visit the public network. And for the fixed IP solution, we also use a net proxy, and we use an HIP to scale. When you visit the public network, you firstly need to go to the HIVIPB and then go through the net proxy. Finally, I'd like to talk about that cold start is really important because we rebuild the function architecture for much large scales, and we deploy micro VM system for rapidly deployment. Finally, we build cold cache and autoscaling and a VPC net proxy for lower load start, cold start latency. These are our QR code. If you have any questions, you can scan the QR code and join our WeChat group or follow our official WeChat account. Do you have any questions? Maybe we can take one question. So you have the SNET on the proxy. When you exchange, maybe you will lose all of the contract for the SNET. SNET, we have SNET synchronization, and when we exchange, we will exchange the master to state 5. So we won't lose the NetSNET status. And maybe we can talk afterwards.
感谢大家啊，有问题的话可以加一下，就是。
Thank you. If you have further questions, you can scan the QR code, join our.